Today is November 29th, and you're listening to the Explore the Symphony podcast with Jean-Jacques Van Vlasler coming to you from Studio P3 at Canada's National Arts Centre in Ottawa. I'm your host, Marjolaine Laroche, Assistant Principal Bass of the NAC Orchestra. In episode 2 of this series, we look at Dvořák's Symphony No. 9, the New World Symphony. Jean-Jacques Van Vlasler, it's a pleasure to see you again. And we had a fantastic conversation last time about Beethoven. Today, we talk about Dvořák, Antonín Dvořák, who's a Czech composer and who composed one of the favorite symphonies in the world, the New World Symphony. So,
it's an absolute favor, in fact, absolute favor with the public, certainly. Perhaps a little bit less so with musicologists, but I will explain this a little bit later. So, yes, Antonín Dvořák. Antonín Dvořák, you know, his lifespan is essentially the second part of the 19th century. Born in 1841, he died in 1904, and not a very long life, 63 years, but a very important period in the life of his country also. Well, we'll come back to that too in a few minutes. He was born 2 years after Mussorgsky, 1839, or 1 year after Tchaikovsky, who was also somebody he knew quite well. He didn't know Mussorgsky, but he knew Tchaikovsky quite well, as he will know quite well other contemporaries of his, like Johannes Brahms. So what period is that? Well, it is still the last period of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, run by Franz Josef, Kaiser Franz Josef. You know, now we know him as the husband of Sissi, of this wonderful, beautiful young lady called Elizabeth. And so Franz Josef, 1848, 1916. So the life, essentially life of Dvořák is in that period. Now, it is the end of an empire. And Bohemia, where Dvořák was born, in a little village called Nelahoseves, he is part of that large empire. In that period already, we had talked about nationalism in a way with Beethoven already, the upcoming nationalism, when we talked about the Ninth Symphony. Well, there were two major parties within Bohemia, the party of the old Czechs, and that party wanted autonomy for Bohemia and Moravia within the empire. And then there was the party of the young Czechs, and that those wanted a total independence. So you see there are movements there towards nationalism. There is the birth of a social democratic party in 1870, you know, essentially made out of workers. You know, the industrialization is coming along, not totally in Bohemia, because Bohemia are wonderful woods and rolling landscape. It's a most marvelous part of what is today the Czech Republic, obviously. And at that time, there are, and I want to say a few words about the language. You know, Czech language had almost completely disappeared, and it was only kept in some of the outside the large cities by farmers at the countryside. That's where people still spoke a little bit of Czech. And there is a renewal of interest into the language as such that was spoken there. Dvořák spoke the language. He will have to go to the big city or to a larger city later on to learn German.
Aha, so you're telling me that he was an old-fashioned nationalist.
He as a little boy, he didn't think too much about those things. He was in a period where, you know, it was not a rich family. This was a poor family.
What did his father do?
Well, his father was the owner of a cafe, and it's not really a bar, but it's a place where people go and have their local bar to have your beer. You see,
right?
And very good beer, by the way, in Bohemia. And it's a birthplace, you know. Anyhow, some people will not like what I just said, but that has nothing to do with music, so I'm vulnerable to that. So in those wonderful, this little boy, these wonderful rolling hills in this little village, which I visited, by the way, many years ago, this little boy is surrounded by not only the local language, but also by the local rhythms, polka rhythms, by the music that is called the Furian, which is called the Dumki. There is a famous trio by him called the Dumki Trio, because he will use that kind of rhythm. So surrounded by folk music. And this little boy, of course, will be hearing traveling musicians, wandering musicians, if you want to, you know, and he will learn the violin, but, you know, like that, like most of the children at the countryside, when you're a little bit gifted, he took up the violin. He will be singing at the church as a chorister. He will play for the local little orchestra, for weddings, for example, and composing. Before 12, composing little waltzes and little marches. That is, I think, a very important thing. So the family knows that this
he's
little
got
boy
something, this
has
boy.
Something. Yeah. So they have to send him out at 12, and then we are then in 1853, to another little village, a place that is a little bit larger, and it's called Zlodice. And there he will learn German. As we said a few minutes ago, he will learn piano, he will learn violin, he will learn organ, and his first lessons in harmony. So he's getting there. For 4 years he will stay there, and then he will go to the big city, to Prague. We are in 1857, and he is sent to the organ school. And you know how he traveled to the organ school? Well, he went on a hay cart. That was the way to go it. Later on, as you know very well, Marjolaine, he will become a very great fan of a different kind of traveling mode, which are the trains, which was quite new at that time, of course. And he will become one of the famous musical train spotters in the world. Okay, this being said, he is now in Prague, and he will be essentially going to the organ school. But to earn some money, he will go and play in the Czech National Opera Orchestra. He will play alto.
The viola.
Viola, yes. Yeah, braccia in German. Yeah. Yeah. All kinds of different names for the same instruments. You know, how can they make life
And he played
difficult?
For some famous people in that orchestra.
Well, you know who the conductor was?
Tell me.
Smetana.
Not so bad.
Yeah, not so bad. Bedřich Smetana. And it is important, and that's why I wanted to bring it up to this point. This Smetana is the leader in musically of what will be the cultural nationalism in that part of the world, Bohemia, Moravia, later the Czech Republic, of course, and Dvořák will be his natural number two later on.
So Dvořák is a successful student, successful in his contacts also, if he played under Smetana, whose thinking is along the lines of his own.
Absolutely. And he will learn a lot from that environment and the vibrant environment at that time in Prague. Prague is, let's not start talking about that extraordinary and mystical city, which is Prague, mysterious city also. But it is in fact in that period, in the 1860s, that there is his road to self-discovery. Now, when I say self-discovery, he starts composing real works. He has composed also for piano, he has composed for chamber music, and later on he will compose for major works like the Requiem Mass and the Stabat Mater. But that, we are talking essentially now about the symphonies, obviously, because we're going towards the Ninth Symphony. And what he does, very often in the beginning, that self-discovery, he will destroy lots of his scores, the beginning, the first scores. One of the scores that he sends off for a competition in Germany is a symphony. And I'm telling this story because it's going to be important later when we will discuss the numbers of the symphony and the plays of the symphony. So we sent it off to Germany. And of course, as very often in competitions, the organizers of the competition don't send the score back. So the score was lost. And it will be only be discovered in 1923 in a second-hand dealer's shop by a certain gentleman called Dr. Rudolf Dvořák. No family whatsoever, but Dvořák is a quite common name in Bohemia. So in that shop in 1923, so Dvořák has been dead for 19 years already, and then calmly people will, the musicologists will discover that this is in fact a first symphony that he had composed, and he had composed that first symphony in 1865, so he was 24 at that time.
So you're telling me, and you're going to explain this now to us, because this is a problem with Dvořák. I have this problem myself. When we're told you will play Dvořák Fifth Symphony, I never know which record I'm going to go by. Is it the fifth? Is it the eighth? Is it the ninth? Because there's the symphonies he wrote and then the symphonies he published and the symphonies that were discovered after his death. So can you explain that a little bit to us?
That first symphony, the one I was talking about a few seconds ago, has been one of the problems. And then, after that first symphony, he will compose four other symphonies. And of course, when one uses symphonies by numbers and not by their B flat major or E flat major or D minor or F major, then of course there could be some confusion. And what was the confusion? First, nobody knew about that first, later discovered symphony. Mm-hmm. Dvořák didn't know about it anymore. So that's why there were only total eight symphonies. And the last of those symphonies would be the New World Symphony, and that's why people gave it the number eight. Once we discovered that number one, then it could become number nine. You're asking, why is it not symphony number five? Because the four first symphonies by Dvořák were discarded and not published, and people simply started counting from the fifth symphony on. Five, six, seven, eight, nine. When you start from five on, you only have five symphonies. And so the ninth symphony became the fifth symphony.
Right. So for our listeners who want to go out and who really would like to hear his first symphony, how he started off, which one will they buy?
The first symphony. I don't think I have ever seen a recording of that symphony called The Bells of Slonice. Now, Bells of Slonice, why Slonice and why the bells? Well, this is that second little village where he went to study and learn German, piano, violin, organ and harmony, where he lived for 4 years between he was 12 and 16. So his first symphony was a kind of memory alley into his very very young teenager years. And I have not seen that symphony, and I must say very honestly, I have never heard it. The other symphonies are not very often played. Most of the symphonies that are played are from the fifth symphony on. So that's what it was, five, six, seven, eight, and then you get nine, which is the New World Symphony. The best way to go around it is to ask for the E minor symphony, which is the ninth symphony, which is also the New World Symphony.
Right. So Dvořák has on record nine symphonies, five that are known and that have been studied. Now, did he contribute at all to the change, to the evolution of the symphony?
As such, not really.
So he didn't change the form?
He didn't change the form. He will try to do that in the seventh and in the seventh and the eighth, and I will come back to that in a few seconds, but he will try to get there. But I want first to try to characterize a little bit what these symphonies are about. Of course, he will take the Haydn form. you know, the form that Haydn has set as a model, you know, four movements and the sonata form within those movements. Essentially, the first and the last movement, some of the other ones cannot, but the slow movement also. And then you have, of course, the dance, which very often are, of course, Bohemian dances. I was talking about the Furians, I was talking about the Dumke, and some other rhythms that he picked up from the folk.
There's one element maybe that he added, which is the cyclical element, where he takes a theme that he uses in the first movement and he will bring it back and use it in the last movement or throughout.
But you see, that happened with most of the composers in the second part of the 19th century. You know, César Franck is a great example of that. And the symphony in D by César Franck is an absolute cyclical element. And in fact, also Berlioz started doing things like that much earlier in the symphony.
Even in that aspect, he's not innovating.
He's not. You know, he is more of a follower, in fact. And so what is characteristic essentially for him? Well, with some composers, like with Mahler or Verdi and Tchaikovsky, you know, what do composers say? Well, with Mahler, Tchaikovsky, Verdi, it's the rapport with the fellow men. With people like Bach, Victoria, Bruckner, it's the relationship with God. With others, Debussy in La Mer and Sibelius in Tapiola, it's the relationship with the world of nature. With him, it's all in there, but it's essentially the Czech countryside, its people, that are the formative influences. And it radiates its richness, its generosity of feeling. And with him, and that's what it is all tempered by a keen musical discipline. He knows how to bring it together. But he knows how to bring it together, but he will have to work on it in his first symphonies. His first symphonies, the second and third, are very much influenced by Wagner, for example. By Wagner's music, yes. So he has heard works like Tannhäuser and most probably other works, and he tries to open up within I think even a string quartet has been very much influenced by the kind of music that Wagner was promoting. Later, he will be much more influenced by his friend Johannes Brahms. And when we get to the Seventh Symphony, we will see that it is in a way a consequence of Dvořák hearing the Third Symphony by Brahms. So when he gets into the later symphonies, he will be more and more influenced by Brahms, who has helped him publish his works and who has helped him also with advice also. So when he gets to the, and perhaps, but something about Brahms, you know, because it is an important relationship. Brahms said about him, I quote, "I should be glad if something occurred to me as a main idea that occurs to Dvořák only by the way." You know, Dvořák is a great tune writer. He's one of those, like Tchaikovsky, tunes come very easily, very easily. And that in a way, Schubert also. And Schubert was one of the people he admired very much also. He has that kind of countryside feeling to the symphonies which Schubert had also.
So Dvořák has a feeling, and when you listen to Dvořák on the radio, without knowing what it is, you know it's Dvořák.
Absolutely.
Now, and the melodies come easy, and he's very tied to his country, but he ends up in the States. Now, that's quite a way to go.
Yeah, it's quite a way to go. But he's not the only one that will go to the States. In fact, he prepares the traveling conquering Great Britain first on the way to the United States. But it happens in several times, obviously. In 1884, he plays at the Royal Philharmonic Society in London. his sixth symphony, and they ask him for a new symphony, and that's what I was saying a few seconds ago. You know, he hears Brahms' third symphony, just new, you know, just created, and he knows which one he's going to compose. And in that seventh symphony, he works on it between December 84 and 85, and he's trying to be less nationalistic. The symphony goes in depth, it's much more into seriousness, in fact. And this seventh symphony is, in fact, the most consistently perfect one of all his symphonies. So,
for our listeners, what key is this one in?
The seventh symphony is in D minor.
In D minor.
And he is 43, 44 years old when he composes that one. And you see, he, and in fact, I mean, there are several elements I can bring to that. He gets 3,000 mark for the publishing, which is enormous at that time. He will get, of course, for the Ninth Symphony after the United States, he will get 7,500 mark, which is an important sum at that time also. Musicologist called Tovey said, and I quote, "Dvorak, when he's at the height of his power, happens to be a great master of the long meandering sentence that ramifies into countless afterthoughts." And this is, the ramifying is no rambling. It is, in fact, an effortless flowing. And that's what happens in that seventh symphony. Slow movement is, I think, Dvorak's greatest. You know, it's warm, it's lyric, and it recalls Schubert's great symphony. So, and then after that, he will go between 1884 and 1890. He will be going to the States in 1891. So in those 6 years, he will go 8 times to England. England was a very important country at that time for musical life. They were ahead in concert halls. They were ahead in inviting people also. You know already about Haydn. Haydn went twice. Then Haydn, that was the century before. Haydn went. Mendelssohn was a great guest and a regular guest of the English concerts. Dvorak will be also one and a quite good conductor. Now, 1884... he has finished that Seventh Symphony, which is the most consistently perfect, and he gets into that Eighth Symphony. And it goes together with a new little country house, which he bought. He starts to get a little bit of money. In 1884, he's well known. He buys that little country house in Wysoka, and he writes the symphony there in a very relaxed and very happy atmosphere. You will have that symphony, in fact, is a new departure. Until the Seventh Symphony, and in the Seventh Symphony, he masters completely the sonata form. He's there. He's a late bloomer in a way, although he's very gifted and he's, in a way, he's a genius within music, but he's a master. His perfection only arrives in the Seventh Symphony, and in this symphony, in the Eighth Symphony, he tries more experimentation. Instead of molding his ideas into preconceived elements like the sonata form, each of the ideas come to life and takes over the course of events. And we're getting much closer to Schubert, in fact. Wanderer, just walking through the music and
so
going.
He's transcending
somewhere.
The form.
And he's transcending easily. The form. Absolutely right. Absolutely right. So the second movement again is luminous. I mean, it shows very much what you said a few seconds ago, the organic power of his musical thinking. So There we go. And then suddenly, after the conquest of England, he gets a letter in 1891 from a lady called Jeanette Turber, who is the wife of a wealthy New York businessman. But she is an absolute extraordinary personality on the New York scene. I'll come back to that in a few seconds, because meanwhile, he is an established composer. Dvořák is the established composer. She needed an internationally known figure to run the conservatory, which she had just founded. And he thought of, let's say, when he was offered $15,000 per year, he thought of it twice, refused it first, accepted it then at the end of December. I think his letters of the 21st of December, 1791, he accepts to go to the United States, to New York especially.
Wouldn't that be a huge amount of money?
That was a huge amount of money. And for that huge amount of money, he has to teach composition, of course. And it's a 2-year contract. He gets 4 months free per year, and he has to conduct 10 concerts in New York.
Not bad.
That's not bad. You know, that's now the minimal also for conductors these days. I think when you're a music director, 10 programs per year is about the minimum. Most of them do more, obviously, these days. It's difficult for him, of course. Mm-hmm. It's difficult for him because he has nostalgia for Bohemia, you know, and he will have... he'll have to leave his job. He was at the conservatory in Prague already at that time, but he will go for less than 4 years to the United States. He will start a second contract, and he will not finish totally that second contract. So.
Does he bring his family with him?
He took first part. This is an interesting question, and I have an answer for that. He brought in on the first trip when he left on the 15th of September 1892. His wife comes with him and two of his children, but four of the children stay with his mother-in-law in Bohemia, in Prague. Those children, and I know it only by chance, those children will arrive in New York a few days after he finishes the Ninth Symphony, because he puts on the manuscript, thank God, I'm quoting by heart, you know, thank God the children arrived in good shape or healthy or safe is the word, safe in Southampton. They were ready to travel to the other side. And he puts it on the last day he finishes the Ninth Symphony, which is an anecdote, of course, but that's how I found out.
Mm-hmm. So he has his family with him. He has, now he has composed the Ninth Symphony. He did that in New York. Mm-hmm. I wonder, now we will get into the Ninth Symphony, which is the object of our conversation, but was it well received?
Oh, it was remarkably well received. I mean, it was remarkably well received, the Ninth Symphony. Mm-hmm. Let me take one step backwards. This lady, Jeanette Thurber, is an important figure. You know what happens? She not only started this conservatory, which will only be abandoned in 1956, but she started at the same time also an opera company, as a different opera company from the Metropolitan, because the Metropolitan was for her. All those voices that came from Europe, and she wanted to have an American opera company. It is about cultural nationalism. The way Dvořák was about cultural nationalism when he was in Bohemia. she's not the only one around. There are three major figures around Dvořák at that time. I think it's important to mention them. Not only Jeanette Turba, but also the dean of music critics, the major music critic in New York. At that time, music critics were important. Henry Edward Krebiel. He was of German origin. And he, too, embraces the notion of cultural nationalism. He had a dual allegiance, of course. You know, he liked the old worlds, you know, the Beethoven, the Mozart, and he was also pushing that kind of music, but at the same time, cultural nationalism. He will write remarkable articles about Dvořák. His articles reflect, in fact, what Dvořák is telling him and what Dvořák is trying to do within his music. And the third person is the conductor, Anton Seidel. And Anton Seidel is also of Germanic background, and he is the major conductor at that time in New York. He will organize six German language seasons at the Met, conducting them. Full German language seasons. And then at the New York Philharmonic, he's the leading concert conductor. He will do the premiere of the Ninth Symphony. He too is for, these were very enlightened people, all three of them. And they say, no, we have to create an American school of music. And when Dvořák arrives, he agrees fully with that. He knows America. What was America at that time? Oh my God, America! You know, we are in the 1890s. We're in the last gap of what Mark Twain called the Gilded Age. You know, everything seemed to be in a state of flux. Yeah, in the United States, less so. In fact, in New York, and I'll come back to that. You know, America was changing from a rural agrarian federation to an industrial urban nation state, and you know, and somebody said from an Arcadian vision of paradise into an independent world power. Okay, we won't go further on that. There was the big change happening at that time. Rail lines were transcontinental. We remember that Dvořák loved the rail and the trains. Telegraph wires spanned the country, and America's restless population was spilling to the west. In fact, closing the era of the frontier. Mm-hmm. Oh, that, but then in New York has an extraordinary musical life at that time. Do you know that the orchestras, both the New York Philharmonic at that time and the Boston Symphony Orchestra in the other city, obviously, are certainly as good as the European orchestras, if not technically better. So they play the big repertoire. There are important premieres, and concert going was a response not to snobbery necessarily, but to emotional needs and to aesthetic urges. You see, and so unprecedented artistic and financial prosperity. And at the same time, the culture was blooming. So it is a very good environment to come. When he arrived, he had read in translation the Hiawatha legend. So Dvořák knew a little bit. Well, he was interested in those things. He was as interested in what the First Nations were about, that the term. He doesn't use those terms, obviously. We're in another world. And what the Afro-American world was about. He will have, as a student, a very important person during those 2-3 years. His name is Harry Burley. And Harry Burley is Afro-American, and he will sing him Negro spirituals. So there it goes. Now we have the singing by Harry Burley. So rhythms, syncopations will be part of what he will pick up. And also, of course, his idea of what the First Nations could be about, of his reading by Hiawatha. At a given moment, I think he thought of writing something about Hiawatha, about the legend. It's not him who will compose about it. It is Seidel, the conductor, who will start an opera, and he only finishes the first act. He dies quite young. He dies at 48 or something like that. The poor man, he was born in 1850 and he dies at 1898, so 48. Dvořák is sensitive to American vernacular. And may I quote Dvořák? And now, this is his language. I quote, "The Negro melodies, the songs of the Creoles, the red man's chant, or the plaintive ditties of the German or the Norwegians, the melodies of whistling boys, street singers, and organ grinders, this is the music of the people." So the little boy, the little boy of Bohemia, had kept the idea of the, you know, the wandering musicians and the local music. And further, he says also, "I came to discover what young Americans have in them and to help them express it." And when I say that his student, he had students, Harry Burley, he will have other students, Rubin Goldmark. Goldmark will be one of his students, Horacio Parker. He will have an impact on the next generation, because these people will have an impact on the next generation. And you know on whom? Charles Ives, George Gershwin, Aaron Copland, and Duke Ellington. These are people that were students or have worked with some of the students of Dvořák. And I think this is interesting.
Very interesting. And you're saying basically that this American sound, or romantically American sound, came from this Czech guy that came to visit for just a couple of years. That's what you're saying, in essence.
Yes. Well, that
is extraordinary.
It is rather extraordinary, because he understood what it was. But he was a stranger in a strange land. I mean,
so do you think the fact that he was a stranger made him more open to the this novelty of sound, and rather than somebody who had been born in America?
In the first place, he's a real musician, and he hears what society is giving us as music. That's what he was interested in, within his own music. Mind you, I do think that basically, even in the New World Symphony, he stays a Bohemian composer.
Let's get into it. Let's get into the New World Symphony, if you'd like.
Yes, I will be... How can we get into that one? Well, he starts composing it on January the 10th of 1893, and he finishes it on May the 24th of 1893. So about 4 months: January, February, March, April, May. 5 months. It's quite rapid, because he's somebody who it seems also natural, and it is in fact. It is art about art. The man works a lot on it, mm-hmm. works a lot on his thing. So it's rather rather fast of the way he works on it.
Could we go straight to the movement that we all know? And I thought for a long time that this movement was from what is called a Negro spiritual.
Yeah. And the second movement.
The slow movement.
And the second theme, in fact.
Going home.
Yeah.
Going home. And as a matter of fact, he's such a genius that he composed this. And it was adapted later on, right?
Well, and it's carried by the English horn.
Yes.
It's carried by the English horn. And, it is inspired, in fact, by Burley's voice. Remember his student Burley singing?
Yes.
It is inspired. And it is inspired. It is not an imitation of what he was singing. It will become, in fact, a Negro spiritual afterwards. It will be adopted as a Negro spiritual, but I think the movement is going in the other way, and so this is of course within the most deeply felt of the four movements. I think the second and the third movement are absolutely beautiful. The first and the last are more contrived and more mechanical. They're more foreseeable than in the seventh and eighth symphony. And that's why I was talking about those two symphonies a little bit to introduce it. So, but the second and the third movement are absolutely beautiful. And the third movement, you know, very lyrical, very vigorous, wonderfully fresh. Now, why do people listen more? Or I will take it from another side. The work to get into Dvořák's works, into Dvořák's production, is the Ninth Symphony. Like for Beethoven, it's the Fifth Symphony very often. Or for Tchaikovsky, it's ballet scores. But why do people go into that? Because I do think that the public at large has an unerring instinct in these matters. It's the most famous of his symphonies, it's the most popular of his symphonies, and it's the work that people would say, oh, I want to listen to other works by this composer. And because I think it has, overall, a great freshness to it, and a great directness, inexhaustible directness, directness and freshness, and that's what it is. And of course, those two wonderful middle movements,
tender and gentle,
lyrical. The way the man was.
So he was a good guy. He was a nice man.
He was a nice man. Yes.
Yeah. What devices does he use in this symphony? You know, I know that Dvořák, he added something in color. You recognize the color Dvořák because he adds a lot of piccolo, triangle, a lot of added percussion and stuff like that.
Yes. So, more than in his other symphonies, yes.
Yeah, yeah. So he uses certain devices that make his work recognizable. It makes his work move along.
Yes, but in this one also, a few, you know, the instruments you mentioned, I find give him that little help to pour it into the new words.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, you know, the texture of his voice is Dvořák. You know, you hear two bars and you say,
So what is it?
Hello, Antonin.
Yeah. What is it that makes his sound his own?
What makes a sound? It's really the instrumentation, the orchestration of those pages. I mean, and it's also it is very interesting the way he uses instruments, the warmth of the instruments. You know, you can use instruments in all kinds of ways. You know it better than I do. I mean, and you can make them harsh. You know, the same instruments play Stravinsky.
I've noticed that as a bass player, one of the first symphonies that you play is the New World, and he knows how to make an orchestra sound good. What I'm trying to say is, younger orchestras sound good when they play Dvořák.
This is interesting coming from a musician. I very often say that it's because people have heard it so often that they hear it in their mind and don't hear the orchestra playing it even badly. There are works like that. Very often, you know, public goes to concerts and, you know, and I do sometimes also. I mean, I sit down and I listen to it the way I want to hear it. Because I know most of those works by heart and listen to it. And some of those very popular works, Ninth Symphony, people know the tune. And they project the tune on the orchestra without listening to how it's played very often. But it is a work of genius, and this is a composer of genius in his way.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you very much, Jean-Jacques. We could talk and talk and talk about Dvořák. It's nice to know that he was a good man, a gentleman, and that we could. It's too bad that he lived such a short life.
Yeah, 63 years old. It's a very short life, in fact, a very short life. But you know, Mussorgsky was in his 30s, and Tchaikovsky was in his early 50s, and. And then we won't speak about Mendelssohn, 37, and Mozart, something like that, 36 years old. And poor Schubert, 31.
That's true, eh?
Oh, yes, yes. Conductors live much longer.
Very, very old. Bass players, I hope so, too. And music critics? Jean-Jacques?
Well, that depends if they're stressed, you know, writing their articles.
It was a pleasure to talk to you.
Pleasure
Thank
to
you
talk
very
to you.
Much. That's all for this edition of Explore the Symphony. Send us your comments and questions. You can reach us by sending an email to nacpodcasts@gmail.com. Don't forget that you can subscribe to this and other NAC podcasts by visiting nacpodcasts.ca. There you'll find our past episodes, subscription links, and instructions on how to subscribe. You can also easily find this podcast as a free subscription in the podcast section of the iTunes Music Store. Search on Explore the Symphony. The musical excerpts you heard in this podcast are used with the permission of Naxos of Canada. Until next week, this is Marjolaine Laroche for Jean-Jacques Van Vlasler and the new media team at the NAC saying goodbye from Canada's National Arts Centre.